Jetlagged podcast.
Welcome to Automated. I'm your host, Mark Verbenkov, and in this weekly podcast, we will be exploring the impact of emerging technology on jobs, society, as well as us, with business and technology leaders, researchers, and independent professionals across the world. So even though I'm back in Barcelona after the holidays and very jet-lagged, I'm really happy to finally release this week's episode with Malcolm Ross of Appian. So we actually recorded this before the holiday break, and it's great to finally be able to share with you the wealth of knowledge that I think Malcolm really brings on low-code, enterprise software, and automation in general, especially as this is a new topic for the podcast and a technology that has, I think, gotten significantly more important over the course of the pandemic crisis. So Malcolm is the Deputy CTO at Appian and a product leader in enterprise software with over 22 years of experience. So he has led high-performance teams across product development, sales, and marketing. And today he explains the importance and size of enterprise software, how Appian and low-code in general are changing how the software is implemented and used, and how the future of enterprise automation will be different. Great. Well, I am here today with Malcolm Ross from Appian. Thank you very much for coming on to the podcast, Malcolm.
Thanks, Mark. It's great to be here.
Awesome. So one of the things that I like to do with a number of my guests is, before we talk about the technology and kind of the interest in automation that we both have, what initially got you interested in what you're doing now? So we'll be talking about, you know, enterprise automation, low-code automation, hyper automation, these sorts of things. What was kind of the initial interest personally for you?
Well, for me personally, I've been a bit of a computer nerd my whole life. So I got into kind of software development and computers in the late 80s when I was just a young teenager. And then kind of really focused on a variety of areas of software development and computer science. But centered in kind of the late 90s, early 2000s around what was known in the space as workflow, business process management. So I had some projects when I was much younger, doing things like building a 2QM tracking system. It's total quality management, which was a report tracking system on the performance of call center operations for a credit card agency back when I was like 22 or so. And kind of got into that applications of it. It was always an interesting space to see not just how software, we use software a lot to say distribute content over the internet. But I think we're kind of at a point where we're realizing now the full potential of software to automate our lives and automate many things. And I've always had an attention to that as far as the orchestration of activities, orchestration of content and data across many systems. It's been where I've specialized personally for the past 22, 23 years now. So, yeah. In my role right now, so I lead product strategy at Appian, which is a leading process automation company today.
Great. Well, thanks for that. And I'm sure that the transitions that you've seen over the last 20 years or so have been quite considerable, not even talking about COVID, but I think.
Well, COVID's been a transition itself. You know, 2020 has been a big year. But, you know, the past 20 years, I think the really thing that's changed is really just the focus on, you know, cloud native architectures, cloud scale architectures. You know, when we were thinking about automation 20 years ago, it was often departmental, small organization structure. Now we can really think about big orchestrations, global orchestrations across the entire organizations, as well as what you can do now with artificial intelligence, the access to these big data sources, and the raw computing power to process that very quickly really enhances the capability for even more automation in the decision process of how things decide where to flow through a process automation.
Yeah, absolutely. This is some of the stuff that we talk about on the podcast here with a number of guests. It's really fascinating to see the kind of large scale shifts that are able to be done through these kinds of technologies that you're talking about. I do want to talk about maybe in a couple of minutes about hyperautomation, the book that is connected to Appian. But one of the things that I actually saw that was quite interesting was, I've worked for smaller businesses for my entire professional career. I think Appian does a lot of work with larger companies that have many of these large, complicated, complex processes that are in place. Maybe you could touch on just a little bit, kind of like the scale to which
software is really embedded in some of these larger industries, larger organizations nowadays. There was one section of the book that I was reading that was, you know, software is now kind of the spinal cord of a lot of these businesses. And if the, yeah. if the spinal cord isn't fluid, then the company itself can't really change or deal with any kind of change that's being forced upon it.
Yeah. If you look back, you know, again, how software maybe has evolved also, you know, software was seen maybe in the 90s, even early 2000s, as much like buying a piece of real estate. It was like a static asset that you invested in once and then used over a period of time and depreciated over a period of time. And I think organizations, especially big enterprises, have gone to recognize software as not, say, like a capital investment, but rather kind of a continuous investment. It's something that is the drives the operations of the organization, fluidity of processes and automations, things like this. So that's really been a core mindset change from kind of like that one static thing. I'm going to buy an ERP and it's going to run this. And then you realize that software is quite different. You know, unlike a capital, like a real estate investment, you can change it. You can morph it. You can expand it, contract it. You can do all sorts of things with it. And now today, it's really about a fluid management of software. It's about agile principles, constantly evaluating business conditions and adapting to those business conditions using your software technology. And how we are today as well is, especially in the age of COVID, as we were talking about, you know, as we're in lockdown at our homes, how we engage with the world even more is through these digital Zoom calls and the online web. And all these are digital access points to organizations. How do I order lunch today? It's through a website now. How do I get from here to there? Maybe I order an Uber or a Lyft. It's all these digital interactions now in order to engage with customers, engage with their business partners. So it's become tantamount to really invest in very solid digital experiences for all your different business operations.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is what Appian is working on, trying to make this smoother, trying to make it faster. Can you maybe discuss a little bit about Appian and what you guys do? Because I think it's quite interesting and relevant very much for the topic.
The core principle that Appian brings is simplicity. You know, we try to recognize that what organizations are trying to do is very complex, right? So how you actually order an Uber, you know, and arranging the driver to come to your house at a certain time and have the exact time when it comes and then having them take you to your destination and orchestrating that with maximum efficiency is complex. And what also is complex is in building the software behind it. So it's really hard to solve complexity with another thing that's really complex. So what Appian does is we look at all aspects of the entire software development lifecycle from idea, what do I want to do, to the initial composition of that idea, to the testing and security auditing and the resiliency of the application you're going to build, and to bring that to market and continuously monitoring as well. And we bring what we call a low code principle to that, is how can I take every aspect of that software development cycle and make it really easy for even non-technical users to participate in the process and bring that idea to a digital solution as quickly as possible with minimal kind of challenges in learning new tools, as well as minimal challenges in getting it out as quickly as possible. So that's the core principle, and it's constant simplification. I've talked to other investors and things like that, and they ask me, well, you know, what's the end of low code? It's like, honestly, I see probably a 50-year roadmap, because there's so much complexity in software that there's so many little things to improve and to refine and to make it more intuitive and to make it easier for humans to communicate with the software solutions to tell it what you want to do, that there's just bountiful kind of areas to focus on to improve that low code experience.
And can we maybe discuss a little bit about low code, right? For maybe some of the audience members that are maybe outside of this field. From my understanding, I mean, you have obviously coding where you're creating an application, you know, typing in the kind of JavaScript or whatever kind of code that you're using. My understanding of low code is it's much more visually represented. So rather than typing in several layers of code, you already have kind of a package, if you will, that is represented or that code is being represented by that visual image or something like that. And you piece these processes, these images, if you will, together in order to create a process, but it's much more visually appealing and easier for an employee to understand. Is that close to
the mark? Well, that's it. I mean, the principle of low code is trying to flip the paradigm of how we program software. Mm-hmm. Traditionally, traditional coding required the human to learn how to talk like a computer. And this word was called syntax, right? So if you're writing Java, you got to make sure you have your semicolons in place. You got to make sure your structures, your class architectures. There was a lot of training that went into it to be like a professional computer scientist, a professional developer. And even then, it was really hard to do the more complex things. Like if I wanted to do parallel computing across a multi-core CPU, you know, that's really complex for more advanced computer scientists to do. And again, it's forcing often the human to learn the computer to tell the computer what to do. Mm-hmm. We're trying to flip that paradigm. We're trying to allow the computer to understand the human, to allow the human to use more natural language. And humans are inherently visual in how we communicate and teach. So, you know, like whenever we're trying to convey a concept to someone, if we could be in a conference room again, there's often the whiteboard, and we always go to the whiteboard and we draw diagrams and pictures of how we're trying to communicate ideas to another person. Mm-hmm. And that's what we want to communicate to computers. We want to say, let's just draw a picture. You know, if I draw this process, it's going to go from Mary to Jane to Jack to John, and then it needs to go here. I just want to draw that and then have the computer do it. Mm-hmm. And that's what low code is trying to do. We do that though in a variety of paradigms. So, you know, process automation is just one way of conveying something visually. Another way is how you define logic, like business rules. How do I define, you know, if this, then this?
Yep.
Sometimes, you know, teaching someone if then else syntax is more technical. What if I could just use like a Excel spreadsheet, things that we're more comfortable with? And same thing also with like data structure analysis. There's challenges, the challenges in building things like entity relationship diagrams, you know, in a SQL database, you build these ERDs, very complex technical stuff. Well, if I could just say what fields I need and I can maybe nest some things, you know, I can just draw it in a more ad hoc fashion. So what we do at Appian is really kind of explore all those ways of things that we want to tell computers what to do. And we have lots of conversations, our product management team, about what is the best way to have a human talk to that, to make it as simple as possible and for the computer to understand it and do it reliably exactly how it's intended. And then we're also exploring things like applications of artificial intelligence so that as humans tell a computer to do things over and over and over again, sometimes the interpretation's a little wrong and the human makes a correction. Each one of those corrections of how we adjust the programming is an opportunity for the computer to learn from it. So we have in our system baked into like process recommendations. As you drag and drop a node, we'll use artificial intelligence on the computer side to try to predict what the human's trying to do and then start to recommend things and get it one step ahead around predicting what they intend to actually build inside a software solution.
Oh, that's super interesting. I want to go back to what you're discussing there. So the if my understanding is correct, this also might empower the employees themselves to get more involved in the process of creating or of changing the process within their own organization. Is that correct? Because I would assume before it would be much more reliant on, say, the programmer, the software developer in the company to create these kind of processes that they're kind of taking from the employees.
I mean, that's the natural path. Mm-hmm. If you pursue simplification of how humans tell computers what to do, that's the natural path, is to allow more people to participate in that process. You no longer need to go to MIT and get a 4-year degree in computer science. You can now just talk to the computer in a more natural way and have it do what you want. Yeah. And that's basically, I'd say Appian doesn't specifically say, yeah, we're gonna, you know, do sys and development all the way. It's the natural course, you know, to actually allow more people participate. But as well, we're just as focused on this professional developers. Who require a great deal of variability about what they want to tell a computer to do. So sometimes if you work with like a pure citizen development tool, it guides a citizen development on a very narrow path of what you can actually do with that computer. Maybe you can build like a simple mobile application or a simple workflow, things like this. A professional developer needs to have that variability about all the possible logic or paths they need to tell the computer what to do. So we really focus on kind of that higher end, the professional developer, but also still bring the low code mentality to it. And through that, you know, yes, citizen developers or non-technical users can more actively participate in the creation of those applications then.
Okay, maybe for the audience, can we make this a little bit more tangible, right? I think we're talking a little bit higher level. It's fascinating, mm-hmm. but to give somebody maybe a use case so that they can really picture what is going on.
Yeah, maybe like one of our customers, you know, without mentioning the name, one of our customers is one of the larger trucking companies here in the United States. And again, a trucking company, as you can imagine, is challenged in many ways. First, you know, your top tier software developers don't graduate from MIT saying, I'm going to go work for a trucking company, right? So they're trying to work for Google or Uber or one of the hot new startups. So talent acquisition is hard for that top tier software development teams. So you need to have a team structure that, you know, maybe it's more music educated or art educated people who can come in and express what they want the computer to do. So that's part of the challenges. Again, talent acquisition. There's a lot of competition for top tier software talent. That low code tool breaks down because now you can have non-classically trained computer scientists participate. Now, what they need to do though is anything from full lifecycle truck management. So from the rental checkout of trucks to the check back in, to the claims management when there's an accident, to the truck inventory and inspection management, to maintenance and yard checks. All these things are built now on Appian software, which were previously done entirely on paper and green screens. Mm-hmm. So it allows an organization like that to adapt to the modern digital age. No longer, again, like in the age of COVID, you don't need to go to the facility, sign paper forms. You can go everything online, fill out your forms, do your check-in on your mobile device. The expectation that we have today with a touchless, you know, socially distanced interaction now with all the retail experiences we have, they can enable that using a low-code platform, again, without having to get the top-tier talent on software development and mobile application development.
Oh, that's really interesting. This also seems maybe a little bit connected to the book that I think your CEO mm-hmm. was highly connected to, this hyper-automation book. Mm-hmm. It really sounds like... For me, the idea of automation that Appian is working on is more like it's not the traditional, you know, automating the human so the human is no longer there and a robot or a mm-hmm. certain AI technology is there doing the human's job. To me, it really sounds like there's this idea, the central core idea of augmenting the individual employee to be able to do the kinds of things that need to be done in that organization to kind of deal with, you know, whether it's a COVID situation or any other kind of situation.
Yeah, hyper-automation is the idea of not only bringing together a number of automation technologies to drive, but also the idea of, again, aligning automation with human interactions. Mm-hmm. You know, many times in history, we've had these challenges where a new technology fundamentally changes the roles of people inside of an organization, the methods of commerce. You know, we've seen this with like the Gutenberg press, you know, hundreds of years ago, when suddenly it's like monks handwriting, you know, text was entirely going away and he just stamped it out. And we're at one of those periods of time where we should not see that as a massive threat, but it's actually a massive opportunity to invent new ways of what we can do with the technology, new patterns, and expand and help people's lives overall. So when you think about, you know, adapting to automation technology, it's really about not thinking about automation itself, but thinking about the application of automation with humans. What are the areas that I'm having humans do, which is really poor work? Like many times tools like robotic process automation mm-hmm. is using humans to copy, paste, manually enter really poor job experiences. I would say as far as highly repetitive and using humans as robots.
Yeah, could we talk a little bit about robotic process automation? Because that hasn't really come up on the podcast before. And I know that you guys deal with that considerably.
Yeah, Appian directly, we actually embed robotic process automation software with the Appian product. And RPA specifically, maybe to give a definition to it solves two primary use cases. The first one is those kind of manual tasks. There's many jobs in the world where basically their job is just to copy and paste information from one screen to another, to move data back and forth. These are probably some of the worst jobs you can have because you probably get carpal tunnel syndrome really quickly. And again, it's treating people as robots. The other area where RPA adds a lot of value is integration to systems which just have not been modernized. If, you know, a developer like myself, we use things called APIs, which allow us to interact with different systems in a very modern way. It's very easy to integrate these environments, but those legacy environments or those hard to get at data structures, which just don't have these modern APIs, RPA can emulate a human of getting that data and moving it into the location that you want. So RPA kind of serves those primary purposes. Mm-hmm. I think RPA is a perfect example. It is a digital robot. It is a digital worker that is doing something highly repetitive over and over and over again, but in a digital way to eliminate kind of those burdens of humans doing this. And of course, when you do things in a digital way, you can do things with more reliability and accuracy. And you can also repurpose those humans to do things more value add, what humans are very good at, which is knowledge work, coming up with new ideas, across applications, customer service applications, things like this, which add more value to the organization than just treating people as robots.
Yeah, that's great. This is one of the big trends that keeps coming up over and over again in the mm-hmm. podcast with any kind of an industry that's being discussed about. I guess you could even say like emancipating individual workers from these tiresome, monotonous, one could even say soul sucking tasks and jobs, and enabling them to do things that are much more interesting and much more, vital to the human existence.
Probably one of the best analogies is like the Gutenberg press, right? Mm. So literally before then you had, I think it was mainly monks in Europe who were drawing these very elaborate books, and, at the time, they took great pride in these things, right? So if you've seen these books from the pre-Renaissance era, you know, they're beautifully decorated, highly expensive, highly rare. But it wasn't until the Gutenberg press came along where you had a robotic basically stamping out of books that you actually improve the literacy of the entire world, and you actually expand the knowledge of the entire world as well. So automation has great potential to unleash human potential across many different aspects of what we want to accomplish.
Yeah, I couldn't agree further with you. maybe we can talk a little bit about COVID, right? So we were talking about this a little bit before recording. If we're looking at enterprise software as kind of one of these large, spinal cords within many different kinds of organizations over the last 20 years, it's been growing over the last 20 years. What has COVID really changed? I talked to many different guests on the podcast, and there's significant changes in all industries. What is one of the main things that you see with COVID with the clients that you're working
with? Well, with our customers, you know, there's a lot of customers that we are working with who were talking about doing automations and talking about maybe, we know this old system needs to be improved. And then suddenly COVID came along and shined like a giant spotlight on those, what we call sneaker net or old processes that relied on human interactions. There's one case study that I'm reminded of, which is actually a municipality, a city here in the United States, where they were still issuing parking tickets via manual, what we call carbon copy. If you remember these, where you write on it and you tear the piece of paper off and you have a copy, it writes. And so they were doing carbon copy and they stick it on your windshield when you have a parking violation. And then they would send all these carbon copies back to a central processing center where there was literally people sitting shoulder to shoulder processing these parking tickets. Well, COVID came along and you can't have people sitting shoulder to shoulder anymore, but you had these physical parking tickets that couldn't really leave the facility. So they stopped issuing parking tickets. So much to the city's happiness, great, but actually that was a massive revenue stream for the city. So COVID took and shined this big spotlight on these areas that just had failed to keep up with digital times and really accelerated these projects. You know, we had a major grocery store supplier here in North America have this similar challenge where they were, all their truckers were still using paper to basically process all their truck deliveries to the grocery stores. And every time they went to a grocery store, they had to get out of the truck, go through reams of paper and validate all the inventory and a lot of social interaction between them and the grocery store manager to make sure everything was loaded off properly. And they realized, well, I can't do that. I can't have these truckers going from location to location, 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 potentially spreading COVID to all the grocery stores because they couldn't really socially distance that job. So they accelerated the building of a mobile application, which allowed the trucker to stay in the cab while they checked inventory and checked the offload of the entire product. So again, it really highlighted these areas where you need to improve digital operations and accelerate a lot of low code investments to get those to market very quickly.
Mm-hmm. And have you heard from these clients as to how the actual individual employees are finding this? I mean, I could assume that the truck drivers might have previously enjoyed that kind of maybe even a 5-minute interaction or so. But maybe going forward, have you heard from clients as to, you know, the benefits that they're really getting for the employees themselves? Like those jobs changed,
Well, not only the benefits to employees, of course, they're able to maintain healthy distances and with health protocols in this age. Through those more digital interactions, but as well, you see great efficiency gains, you know, huge gains in the amount of stops. I think they reduce like the time at each truck stop or offload by like 20 minutes or so. So you have huge potential gains when you start to actually implement these digital technologies as well. From the human perspective, though, it does allow humans to refocus on the non-monotonous work. They're more efficient, they get more done in the day. And of course they are more satisfied with their job because they're not just doing repetitive work, reams of paper. They're able to kind of focus on their more value add benefits, what humans are good at.
And you're seeing this in many, I mean, I'm assuming that Appian works in many different industries, right? So this isn't isolated to a few industries here and there. It's really kind of the, maybe even a nationwide re-digitalization or even an initial digitalization of many of these processes and many of these businesses, right?
Yeah, our implementations, our customer base is largely across financial services, large government operations across Europe and North America and Australia, as well as insurance. And one of the other big and fast growing areas is pharmaceuticals and life sciences of, you know, any number of ways of how we actually review things like clinical trials. A number of top five pharmaceutical companies use us for clinical trials management and being able to effectively test the or have people check in via mobile devices, report any symptoms they have from taking, you know, early research on drugs and have that entire clinical trial process go faster, as is very important right now with some of the COVID research going out.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've had this COVID pandemic come. It's been a quite a shock to the system, to I guess every single business out there. We're now having this, you know, these digital processes being implemented. It might take a year or so for them to be, I guess, really crystallized into the business practice. What do you see in the next, you know, 5 to 10 years? Do you see that, you know, COVID was just kind of a one-off thing and we have this maybe new digital layer in a, many of these different organizations? Or do you see, you know, a continued perception of, oh, there is actual benefit to both, you know, my bottom line, but also to my employees? And do you think that there will be like more of this, you know, hyper automation, to use it in a different sense?
I think absolutely. You know, I'm personally looking forward to probably vaccine being 100% effective, and we're all, this is all a dream that we'll wake up from in 6 months. Right? but you know, I think COVID has made a permanent dent on how people plan their enterprises, especially around risk management and risk identification. You know, it's probably one of the biggest things that people have identified is the need to scale out or scale down businesses very fluidly. So that doesn't even just affect your software investments of how quickly I can adapt software, but also just your physical investments. You might choose to reduce lease times of retail spaces or reduce lease times of aircraft or transportation spaces. So if another pandemic or number of global incident occurs, you're not tied to multi-year leases that you can quickly scale your business up and down as necessary. And I think that's gonna be an effect probably across organizations. In the context of software, I think low code is a central driver of that. It allows you to be agile, allows to adapt quickly, come up with solutions quickly. And using a cloud native architecture allows you to scale up to high demand instantaneously or scale down to very low demand and have that pricing also be variable and barely what you pay. So there's going to be more, I would say, more move to that as far as like dynamic pricing, dynamic kind of allocation of assets and software engineering to accommodate a very unpredictable world we've learned to live in right now. Right.
Yeah. I think as you were saying, like flexibility is really one of those key terms out there, right? Because if companies weren't very flexible in the past, probably they had you know, legacy systems or you know, really not very advanced digital practices. They could probably survive for a long period of time, not be very innovative or not really expand, but they could survive. But I think with a shock like COVID or you know, future shocks that are most probably going to come in the future, that flexibility was really forced upon them during this period. I think it's really interesting.
I was going to say, I'm reminded of an event. If you remember, before COVID happened, there was all this worry about one of the volcanoes in Iceland was going to explode. If you remember, that was like 4 or 5 years or so before us. And then they were like, oh, it's going to shut down all air traffic. Basically, something that we have right now is like air traffic has been largely shut down. You know, and that's the reality of the world is, you know, a major volcano could happen, another disease could happen, a war could break out. Any of these things could occur. And you need to survive through these environments, you need to be able to adapt very quickly and be able to survive. Actually, Gary Kasparov in the Hyperautomation book calls this out in his foreword, where he says, you know, this isn't really just not a business methodology. It's just Darwinism. You know, those that adapt survive through these pandemics. Those that don't adapt go extinct. And you definitely don't want to be on the extinct side of this. So you got to learn to be agile and adapt very quickly.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think maybe to tie this to the beginning and maybe to kind of as one of the final thoughts, software is really one of the main drivers of this flexibility that we've seen growing, especially I think in the larger organizations over the last 20 years, where you have so many different kind of processes that has maybe even bogged down companies. I think there was actually one part of the Hyperautomation book that was saying, you know, it's a lot easier to even change the entire executive leadership of a company than it is to change the kind of core software digital processes in that company. So
it is.
Yeah. So maybe if out of anything, if COVID has enabled you know, more flexible software, more flexible code through low code and through the work that Appian is doing and yourself, we might, I don't know, maybe see some kind of interesting changes over the next 5-10 years with this hyper flexibility that many organizations are going to be having.
Yeah, is that if anything, COVID shined a big spotlight for everyone to see where those areas of inflexibility were.
Yeah,
and not all of them were solved in the past, 9 months now. So there's still, people are aware of these challenges now and going to be responsive to those, and they're planning in the future as far as how do I not have these inflexibility areas in the future and accommodate the next pandemic or global issue.
Yeah, I think that's maybe a great point to end on, a really pragmatic and kind of a forward looking point. I really like that. Thank you very much for coming on to the podcast. I will have a link to the Hyperautomation book. Is there anywhere else that you want people to connect with you? I'm assuming LinkedIn. Are you on Twitter?
Yeah, LinkedIn's great. On Twitter, mrappian.com, mrappian, Malcolm Ross Appian, or LinkedIn, of course, happy to connect with everyone. And check us out at appian.com if you're interested in checking out some low-code software.
Perfect. Well, great. Thanks a lot, Malcolm. Thanks for coming on.
Oh, thanks, Mark. Great to meet you.
Right on. Well, that's it for this week's episode. Thanks for listening. If you like what you hear and you want to support the podcast and the conversations here, the best way to do this is to go onto Apple Podcasts and leave a review, as it helps the algorithm to reach out to new listeners and brings the show to them. Also, feel free to check out the website, automatedpodcast.org, where you can find the show notes for each episode, written articles on the themes of the podcast, and a library of resources on the topic of emerging tech and automation. Also, if you want to reach out and leave any feedback or you have any questions about the podcast or any of the conversations, there are general contact links such as email, LinkedIn, Twitter, etc. for you there on the website. And finally, for those of you that want more than just an audio conversation, the video recordings are now going to be up on YouTube for the newer conversations. So feel free to check out the videos by searching for Automated Podcast on YouTube, where, of course, you can like and subscribe if you prefer to support the podcast that way.
The Automated Podcast.